This video is an introduction to confidence intervals. The material here is based on the textbook Essentials of Statistics, 4th edition by Mario Triola, and this subject is covered in Chapter 7 of that textbook. This is a crucial point in this course because it is your first introduction to the subject of inferential statistics. As you see here, this course is divided into three major areas. Descriptive statistics are covered in chapters 1 through 3. Probability is covered in chapters 4 through 6. And then inferential statistics is covered in chapters 7 through 11. You see here in this bullet, descriptive statistics and probability lay the foundation for inferential statistics. So this course is really focused on getting to this point and learning about inferential statistics. So what is inferential statistics? Inferential statistics means gathering data from a sample. This is a really important concept. That's why I have it highlighted here in yellow. So we gather data from a sample, and we use that data and statistical techniques to learn something about the population that the sample came from. And again, I have population also highlighted because this idea of samples and populations is very, very important. So most of the problems that you will solve from this point forward will, one, give you information about a sample, and two, ask you to reach some kind of a conclusion about the population that the sample comes from. So in all these problems, it is extremely important that you know when you are talking about a sample and when you are talking about a population, which means you really have to know all of the symbols that are used. And you've come across most of these symbols already in the course, and most of you have probably not bothered to really try to get them straight. Well, now is the time. You see right here it says, memorize these symbols. You've got to do it. I have a table of these symbols in my outline, and I'll talk a little bit later, a little bit more about the outline, but I believe it's on page 4 at the bottom of my outline. This table you will see there. We're going to take a minute and talk about it. You see I have one column here for samples and another column for populations. The question of how many are in a sample, the symbol for that number is this little n, lowercase n. How many are in a population is the uppercase n. You will almost never use this uppercase n. You will use this lowercase n all the time. So get very familiar with that. What about mean or average? If you're talking about the mean of a sample, the symbol for that is x bar. You should presumably know that by now with some of the other work you have done. Whereas the mean of a population, the symbol for that is this Greek letter, which is called mu. If we're talking about a proportion, the proportion of a sample is called p hat. That's the notation for the proportion of a sample. The proportion of a population, the notation for that is p. And by the way, don't get these words mixed up. Proportion is a word, population is a word. They're both long words that start with p. But as you can see, they're completely different things. So don't confuse proportion and population. We'll talk more in another video about what a proportion actually is. What about standard deviation? The standard deviation of a sample, the symbol is S. The standard deviation of a population, the symbol is sigma. And finally, we have this thing here called a correlation coefficient. That's not really going to come up until chapter 10. But I went ahead and put in the symbols here anyway. This is a little r for the correlation coefficient of a sample and the correlation coefficient of a population. It looks like a p here, but that's really a Greek letter called rho, which is spelled R-H-O. Now I want you to notice, when we talk about mean, we can have a mean of a sample and we can have a mean of a population. We can have a proportion of a sample and a proportion of a population, and so on. So all of these things can come up in the context of a sample, and they can come up in the context of a population. If we are talking about a sample, then these things are all called sample statistics, or SS, sample statistics. But if we're talking about a population, then they are called population parameters, or PP. So in other words, a mean can be either a statistic or a parameter. If we're talking about a sample, then the mean is a sample statistic. If we're talking about a population, the mean of the population is a population parameter, and so forth. Very important that you keep these things straight, that you learn, that you memorize these notations, and always keep in mind, are you talking about the sample or are you talking about the population? So what exactly is a confidence interval? When you construct a confidence interval, you are using information from a sample to estimate something about the population that the sample came from. You are usually asked to estimate a mean or a proportion. And by the way, proportion is the same thing as a percentage. And again, we'll talk more about that in my next video. But you might also be asked to estimate a standard deviation. For most of these problems, the calculator will estimate the population parameter by taking the sample statistic and then adding and subtracting something called the margin of error. And that will give an estimated range of values for the population parameter. That range of values is called an interval. I know all of this seems very abstract right now. It will become clear once we start to do some problems in the next video. But I want to lay this groundwork. I'd like you to read these two bullets over and over and over again to get the idea of what you're doing when you construct a confidence interval. Now we're talking about how to compute a confidence interval. There are two ways to compute a confidence interval. One, by hand, or two, using the calculators. In these videos, I will show you how to compute a confidence interval using the calculator. It's faster than doing it by hand, and frankly, it's more reliable. There will be a few things that I show you how to do by hand, but the great emphasis is going to be on using the calculator to be quick and to be accurate, as well, of course, as understanding the problem. Now, one of the biggest challenges in this course, how do you know what kind of a problem you're looking at? And in this case, how do I know a problem is a confidence interval problem? Well, actually, it's pretty easy. The way you know a problem is a confidence interval problem is that it will have these words: construct a confidence interval, or construct a confidence interval estimate. Both phrases mean the same thing. So I have these highlighted because when you see those words in a problem, you know what kind of a problem it is, and you'll know what to do to solve it. What kinds of confidence intervals will we be doing? We will be doing these kinds. We will be doing a confidence interval for a proportion. We will be doing a confidence interval for a mean, and there are actually two kinds of confidence intervals for mean. One is called sigma known, the other is called sigma unknown, and I'll get into that in depth in a later video. And the third kind is a confidence interval for a standard deviation. So I will be doing videos for each of these. There'll be a video for proportion, there'll be a video for mean, there'll be a video for mean when sigma is known, there'll be a video for mean when sigma is unknown, and there will be a video for standard deviation. And finally, let's talk just very briefly about my outline. An overview of Chapter 7 showing all the calculator functions and all the formulas in one place for Chapter 7. This overview appears in my outline on page 5. To print out the outline, go to this URL and click on the link, and I'll show you that right now. So here is that page with that URL that I showed you a minute ago. You see right here it says Statistics Math 200 Help. Here it says Math 200 Outline. And right there is the link. If you click on that link, my outline will pop up in a PDF and you can print it out. And you really should do that. It's especially important starting at this point in the course. So go ahead and print out that outline. So that is the end of this introduction to confidence intervals. The next video I will create will address confidence intervals for proportions. And as of this moment, I have not created any of the other videos. So hopefully I will get those all done soon and made available to you as soon as possible.